It was the dawn of the 20th century, and into the limelight stepped a new breed of bad guys, outlaws who came to symbolize the changing face of American crime, gangsters. Gangsters were tough.
You don't even have to open your mouth. Just look at them like this, and you'll get it down pat, where when you look at a person, that person is gonna know that you mean business.
Gangsters looked smart. They dressed sharp, like back-alley peacocks.
So you can spot these guys on the street instantly. You know who they are, and the way they walk, they swagger. If you roll down the Bowery, a perfect meteor, they said of one particular gang leader.
I remember I saw Lucky Luciano at an airport once. Impeccable. Gorgeous suit, tie, the hair was just right. You know.
Hollywood loved gangsters, wisecracking Robin Hoods, outsiders, underdogs who never stood a chance. The movie sparked a love affair between mobsters and the public that still lives on.
The gangster is probably one of the most recognizable characters we have on screen. Other than a cowboy, I can't think of anybody that immediately, it's shorthand, as soon as he walks onto a set, he's got a swagger, a cockiness. He's screaming, "I'm the bad guy." But he has something that we relate to in the fact that he's ambitious. He rises above the crowd.
Before the rise of the gangsters, criminals had dressed not for the city, but for the prairie. Yet within the first two decades of the 20th century, outlaws swapped Stetsons for fedoras, six guns for Tommy guns, spurs for spats. As crime became a big city thing, the gangster became the trademark for America's industrial age. How the gangsters grew so powerful and so popular reflects the story of modern America. Yet the gangster's roots lay not in the New World, but in the old. Bring me your tired, your poor. This is what the immigrants first encountered. American street hoodlums circa 1900. They looked a far cry from the fashion-conscious mobsters of later years. But these young toughs were every bit as deadly. Street gangs have always been a big part of inner city life. These basketball players today are not gang members, but in their neighborhood, gangs are never far away. And the reasons why haven't changed in over 100 years.
It was your protection, your recognition, your protection in the neighborhood. That was the thing to do in those days. Join a gang, join a street gang, you get respect, you get recognition. You know, instead of being like a nerd, shall we say, in today's times, right?
Back in the early 1900s, the newly arriving immigrants were met by a network of already well-established street gangs. The gangs had odd names. The odder the name, the stronger the gang. The Five Pointers, the Plug Uglies, and the Dead Rabbits.
In this case, dead meant really nifty, and rabbit meant a tough guy. So Dead Rabbits was then taken up like Yankee Doodle was and became, seriously bad dudes, probably would be a good translation now.
The native gangs were strikingly modern. Gang members wore colors. They called their headquarters cribs. They talked of ruling turf. And just look at this, an unmistakable gang sign. Made not by some homie from LA, but by a New York hood way back in 1889. The resident gangs were from different ethnic origins, Irish, English, German. They too had once been immigrants, but now they ruled the roost, and they were determined to make the new kids on the block knuckle under. It's a story as old as America, and it turns some people into gangsters. This was prime gang territory, a part of New York's Lower East Side now known as Little Italy. As immigrants poured into this small district, Little Italy rapidly became the most crowded place on earth. At the hands of the resident street gangs, immigrants fast became victims of robbery, of loan sharking, and of extortion. Of course, everyone wanted out of the tenements. Most got on with backbreaking jobs for lousy pay, scrimping nickels, and saving dimes for the day when they'd have enough to move on. But some couldn't wait. The impatient few wanted out of the ghetto now. After all, there had to be more to life than this.
I'm gonna be somebody. I don't care how I get out of it. I'm getting out of this. What do you got? I got my body, I got my mind, I got my gun, I got my nerve, and I got my guts. Let's go. I'm gonna be somebody. When I walk in, I get the best table.
I have to confront the temptations offered by a life of crime.
I could be dressing like a king. I could be living in my own, you know, quarters uptown. I could be living the life of Riley if I take la malavita, if I take the criminal path, as opposed to this, no doubt virtuous, but poor. It's a terribly poor life.
It's a scene that was acted out before 1,000 tenement windows. A new settler looked out over the promised land. Before him, in the squalor of the slum, lay two options. The question was, which path would the young stranger take? The Promised Land, New York City, 1903. The Lower East Side was a patchwork of warring ethnic enclaves. It was also a powder keg of poverty and crime. Resident hoodlums ruled the streets and victimized newly arriving immigrants. The choices facing immigrants were stark. Stay victimized or join in, become a gangster too, and prey on your own people.
The first avenue of opportunity are your countrymen. You're living in an isolated enclave. You all speak the same language, you don't speak English. So what do? You lean on your compatriots, the ones who have made it, the ones who got here a little earlier, the ones who got a shop, the ones who become a professional.
Inevitably, some immigrant youth took the plunge into crime. Many joined existing gangs. But one renegade group of Italians set up an exclusive gang of their own. They operated in a distinctive way. They took New York by storm. They called themselves the Black Hand.
The Black Hand hits the city in 1903. With tremendous visibility when some guy's found with his head cut off and 17 stab wounds in a barrel on East 11th Street. There was a crime panic, and there was a sense that there was this wave of murders and bombings and terror activities and whatnot, and it's blown into enormous dimensions in the newspaper.
The press had a field day. Immigrants just didn't behave like this. The Black Hand rapidly provoked a reign of terror. In the wake of wild press coverage, filmmakers were quick to spot the potential, making Black Hand movies that claimed to be based on real events. A silent one-reeler has survived from 1906, the dawn of movie history. It's one of the earliest gangster movies ever made. And it deals with the signature modus operandi of the Black Hand, extortion.
You'd send a letter and you say, meet me at, you know, the 125th Street station, 2 a.m., bring pots of money or I'll kidnap your kid or I'll blow your head off or I'll bomb your office. I mean, not profound. And then they put a black fingerprint, you know, a handprint on the thing.
The Black Handers send an extortion note to a shopkeeper, threatening to kidnap his little girl.
They were ruthless and vicious in their tactics. They were thinking nothing of if you refused to pay them tribute, you had a store, let's say, and you refused. They would dynamite your store.
In a scene actually shot on a Lower East Side street back in 1906, the girl is abducted in a hansom cab. This is a real Black Hand leader, Giuseppe Morello.
He basically worked out of East Harlem together with his brother-in-law, Ignacio Lupo the Wolf Saeta. They were very, very vicious people.
So distinctive do the Black Handers look that newspapers began calling them Mustache Petes. Their look was soon copied in the movies. When the extortionists come to collect, police detectives pounce. Contemporary moviegoers would have recognized this as a reference to the Italian squad, set up by this man, Police Lieutenant Joseph Petrosino. Petrosino reasoned that only Italian-speaking officers could hope to penetrate the Black Hand. In a police force dominated by Irish Americans, it was a radical move.
It was his brainstorm, Petrosino, that is, who created this Italian squad, who was able to talk the language of the Italian. There was 500,000 Italians living in the city of New York. More Italians lived in New York than were in Rome.
The Italian squad was the first ever response by a law enforcement agency to the threat of organized crime.
But it doesn't, in fact, work terribly effectively. Petrosino, actually, interestingly, is dispatched to Italy, Palermo, I think, in an attempt to ferret out transatlantic connections. But word of Petrosino's mission precedes him, and the seriously professional gangsters over there kill him.
In the movies, there's always a happy ending. Police surround the Black Hander's hideout and rescue the kidnapped little girl. As a movie, The Black Hand was so successful, the story was to be remade 3 times over the following 15 years. The Black Hand was the first sign of something new in gangland. In time, as the Italian community grew more established and more prosperous, the Black Hand would become known by another name, Mafia. Unlike the Black Hand, most other gangs opened up their ranks to all ethnic groups. And the gang bosses, men with names like Paolo Vaccarelli and Monk Eastman, stalked the sidewalks like urban warlords.
Monk Eastman is an ex-boxer whose head looks like a smashed cauliflower. He's, you know, generally considered to be a serious psychopathic thug. And yet he manages by, you know, force of example energy to sort of assemble this sort of large mass of the folks around him.
It was in the big street gangs that many later celebrity gangsters served a tough apprenticeship. Ben Siegel, Lucky Luciano, Mayor Lansky, the list goes on. They took their knocks, they learned the ropes, and they earned respect at the point of a gun.
And there'll be gun battles on 2nd Avenue where the five pointers, that's Vaccarelli's gang, and the Monk Eastman crowd will shoot at each other from behind girders, you know, the elevator running overhead, much to the dismay of passersby who are being hit by free floating fire. But they're not really defending Jewish territory and Italian territory. I mean, it's a bit of it, but they're defending praying grounds. They're defending stomping areas. They're defending territories in which they have the exclusive rights to extort, to rob, protect illegal businesses and the like.
But the violence didn't stop at turf wars. The gangs tried something new, using violence as a business tool. By the early 1900s, New York street gangs were taking cash to kill. a new phenomenon all too familiar to later mobsters and to moviegoers alike, the contract hit.
Begin to get the first gangs who are literally contracting out as a specialty violence and the willingness to use it. You know, you want somebody's arm broken, it costs so much. You want their kneecaps terminated, here's the hit. Up to the doing the big job, which was quite cheap in those days, I mean, $100.
Murder and mayhem continued to find their way from the streets onto celluloid. Movie gangsters quickly became popular with the very people most likely to fall victim to real gangsters. In the red velvet darkness of Broadway's Bijou theaters, the poor flocked to the silver screen and the dreams it offered. By 1907, in New York alone, 200,000 people were attending the city's 500 movie theaters every day. It was the start of a love affair between the public and gangsters that still endures. With such intense box office interest, filmmakers began hunting for ever more exciting twists to the gangster story. But what they came up with was to change the course of movie history. It looks like just another silent picture. Figures from a bygone era acting in a style that today we find quaintly old-fashioned. But this is the first true gangster movie. In the 1912 feature, Musketeers of Pig Alley, director D.W. Griffith filmed on location in New York's Lower East Side. An unusual move, as most movies at this time were shot in studios. Musketeers of Pig Alley contains all the elements of the classic gangster story, but there's one difference. The extras you see here are not actors. Director Griffith had paid local gang bosses to protect his equipment. As filming progressed, Griffith began using real gangsters in some of the bigger scenes, like this shootout, described in the movie as the gangsters' feudal war. The use of gangsters on screen caused a sensation. The early movies of Griffith and other directors had a feeling of reality about them that was missing from other kinds of pictures.
All of a sudden, it was like going to see a documentary. A lot of people felt that this was the closest they were going to get to meeting these real characters. And that danger, it's a lure. It's like a car wreck. You can't turn away.
Keeping the film gritty and street smart has since become a hallmark of many gangster film directors. The godfather of today's gangster movie genre is being taken for a ride. His movies include Machine Gun Kelly, Bloody Mama, and St. Valentine's Day Massacre. He helped launch a generation of movie gangster heroes. Meet Roger Corman.
I think taking a documentary approach to a gangster film does add to the realism, to the excitement and the sense that this is really taking place. These gangsters lived, they acted on these streets, and to go to those streets and photograph exactly what was there gives an immediacy to the picture that I think does have an impact on the audience.
For 8 decades, realism has been a constant selling point of gangster pictures. But realism was only part of the reason for the gangster movie's growing appeal. Audiences began identifying with the look and style of the bad guy. This is the first major gangster movie hit. Although made in 1921, it harks back to the middle years of the early 1900s. The film was called Outside the Law, and its star was none other than the man with 1,000 faces, the horror movie actor Lon Chaney.
He invents this look, this cornered animal, the cigarette, the cocked hat, the swagger. I mean, that's absolutely recognizable, and it's been repeated thousands of times.
It was Chaney as Black Mike Silva, notorious gangster of San Francisco's Chinatown, who set the style for a generation of gangster movie characters. Moviegoers lapped it up, but they weren't alone. Real gangsters began consciously emulating the tough guy look they saw on the silver screen.
I think the style of the gangster grew out of what they were doing, and at the beginning, you might say it was an authentic style. Then I believe it began to be self-referential. They modified their image to fit the public so that they were almost looking in a mirror in the newspapers and in motion pictures and modifying their own image to be equal to what was in the movie.
Movie influence extended beyond dress code to language. In Outside the Law, during a tussle with a rival gangster in his mall, Lon Chaney is about to make movie history. He utters the phrase that every gangster wishes he'd thought of, the phrase that would later make James Cagney a star, "You dirty rat." But what really struck audiences at the time was the film's violent ending.
It's one of the first movies that is absolutely riveting. You can't take your eyes away from the sheer raw violence at the end of the film. For its time, it was pretty remarkable.
Look at the rawness of this fight scene. A woman bites a man's hand. Bodies physically locked in mortal combat. Hollywood censors found such scenes of violence disturbing. They began to restrict what could and could not be shown on screen. And that was to have unexpected results.
You couldn't show how crime was committed. You couldn't show white slavery. You couldn't show very much of anything. Well, that fed into the creation of the myth, because you did everything then with symbolism, with the shorthand of the dressing, the look. The rackets become oblique. They're not really mentioned, so you're left with a character study. So they helped create the genre by forbidding the show of blood.
Movies like Outside the Law helped define the gangster character. The gangster myth began casting a powerful spell on the minds of the American public. Many people admired gangsters, even though they knew it was wrong. It's something that movie audiences do still.
The American public in general, when they watch a picture, they wish that they were that guy, that everybody fears him, right? But they don't want whatever else goes with that particular character, where, you know, he's every day he's living with the dead tugging at his sleeve. You know what I mean? If you know what I mean.
Movie audiences became entranced by gangster attitude. Gangsters were the guys who lived life by their own rules. Gangsters were kings of the heap. If they wanted something, they took it. Gangsters did it their way. They got help from nobody and they needed no one.
Thumbing your nose at the government, thumbing your nose at authority, and saying, I'm my own man, I'm my own authority. You can't tell me how to live. You can't tell me what's right and wrong. I'll decide. And I think that's the part of it that appeals to the American psyche.
When I was making my gangster films, I was taking a somewhat Freudian approach, and I said the gangster represents the id, that inner drive to satisfy himself by any means whatsoever. And I think we all have that id, we all have that desire, so we respond unconsciously to what the gangster is doing. He's the individual who goes up against society, the man from the outside who attacks the inside, and as we know, 9 times out of 10, the inside wins. But for a moment, he has a victory of his own.
Gangsters were also dangerous, and many people found that danger attractive.
We're interested in everything that is human, including what is dark and what is taboo. For some reason, we allow the gangster to have sins and a dark side. We don't like to look at the good guy, even though he probably has that too. It's very human, so all human beings need to explore what is human.
But gangsters were also vulnerable. They had a fatal flaw. They craved respect. The downtrodden poor of the tenements understood that feeling and sympathized.
Inadequacy has a great deal with criminality, this feeling of being inadequate or uneducated or not respected or looked down. And that's why guns become so deadly. Well, if I can't make you understand and you don't want to give me any respect, pow, maybe you respect me now, huh?
While fictional gangsters began generating box office revenue, real criminal rackets were already netting millions of dollars a year. Robbery, extortion, protection, murder. Crime was becoming big business. At first, neither Hollywood nor the public got the message. Organized crime was no longer in the hands of street hoodlums. Something else, far more powerful, was taking control. It remained in the shadows, a criminal organization so secret that nearly half a century would pass before its name first appeared in the movies. And it looks like a scene from the movies. A candlelit room, a secret ceremony, an initiation into a crime group so deadly that even today some people still hesitate to use its name. Mafia. For 8 decades, scenes like this really happened. Maybe they still do.
They used to have what we called the boss of all bosses.
The boss of all bosses. All right.
And we had the individual bosses of the individual family. Then we had an underboss. Then we have what we call a cover regime, which is a lieutenant.
Here is the birthplace of the mafia in America. The Italian quarter of New York City, Little Italy. Italian immigrants arriving here in the early 1900s faced victimization from already established street gangs. The mafia offered a way out, protection. As angry young toughs, they kept the native gangs at bay, and in the process became local heroes.
The mafia started out trying to help Italian immigrants who came here and who were persecuted and by other groups who were here before they were. See, so they had to unite to sort of help themselves. And they needed to protect themselves from the society at large, which was, you know, denying them jobs and opportunities, right?
But protection came at a price. The mafia demanded tribute from the local community. Apples for the godfather's children. A nice salami for the godfather's table. A payment here, a favor there. The local don rapidly acquired the status of a medieval baron.
People would come, supplicants would line up, and they would ask for favors. You know, my son is in trouble with the police, or I need a job, or, you know, I've been burned out. And he was the local patriarch of this community, and he would dispense favors, and he could, in fact, dispense punishments if you crossed him as well.
As kings of the sidewalk, the godfathers soon came face to face with other local head honchos, ward bosses of the Democratic Party, the Tammany Men, so called after their original headquarters in New York, Tammany Hall. Tammany Hall was a place of wheeling and dealing, barroom brawls and uproar. To stay in power, Tammany ward bosses bought votes. They found people jobs. They helped families in distress. They did favors.
And then they're in a position to help even more, because once they have political power, they can appoint the police who can look after you, they can appoint the judges who can look after you. So the politicians are middlemen, but the lines between political democracy and criminality then get notoriously blurred.
Pretty soon everyone was taking a piece of the action, including the local police. And where cops could be bought, gangsters could take control. As it grew in power, the mafia clothed itself in the fancy language of honor and respect. The mafia was the most exclusive club in town. The mafia remained a shadowy organization, Other gangsters soon learned from mafia methods, the structure, the discipline, the loyalty. One man in particular was to become the definitive crime boss of the gangster era. He was not a godfather, nor a mafioso. As a non-Sicilian, he was not eligible to join the secret club. But he was to build organized crime into a multi-million dollar business. Born and raised in these Brooklyn streets, a man who, more than any other, came to symbolize a new American breed, the gangsters. He believed in the promised land. He pursued the American dream. And he was to set up an organization that became the template for the mob. He was Al Capone. Capone was not an immigrant, but his family had come from Naples. And like other children from immigrant homes, Capone soon found himself running with street gangs.
All these gangs had junior divisions. Capone, at age 13, 14, he was a member of two gangs simultaneously. The Five Point Juniors in Manhattan, and also the South Brooklyn Rippers in his own area of Fourth Avenue and Garfield Place.
Capone's job? Bouncer in a bar called the Hawthorne Inn. Capone's boss was a local hood with mafia connections, Frankie Yale. Acting the role of mentor and godfather, Yale took the young Capone under his wing.
Al Capone was Frankie Yale's student, star student.
Yet Capone was to make his name not in New York, but in a city 800 miles to the west, Chicago. Chicago was a wild town, a boom town. A man could get rich quick here if he had energy and enthusiasm. Local racketeer and nightclub owner Big Jim Colosimo needed a bodyguard for himself and his young wife. Johnny Torrio was Big Jim's number two. He knew Capone from New York and gave him the job. It was the start of a partnership that would change the shape of American organized crime. By the time he was 24 years old, Al Capone was the biggest name in gangland. By then, his face had been marked in a vicious brawl, and he had acquired the nickname by which he has gone down in history, Scarface. Capone became the first true gangland czar. He was a larger-than-life figure, and he made an indelible impression on all who met him.
They would accuse him that he'd say, well, I had nothing to do with this, and my job is selling beer. Well, he had beer, he had gambling, prostitution. He says, I only give what the public demands.
And Hollywood came to love Capone. He had all the ingredients to make him an underworld star. Actor Rod Steiger played Capone in the first full-blown film biography of the mobster.
Al Capone, portrayed by Rod Steiger in a performance of shocking power.
Nobody leaves Al Capone, you understand that?
Well, I do!
Oh, no, you don't!
He was kind of a seductive bully and a thug. He was very clever. He had very good insightful instincts, animal instincts. And he was a hell of a good actor to inveigle people to do things. He either did it by convincing them that they would advance or saying, either you come along with me and won't advance because I'll have you killed. Now, take your choice, my friend, you know.
Please make a deal 3 times.
Steiger's performance brings out the complex enigma that was Al Capone.
I'm doing all right. It takes time.
In one scene, Capone convinces his friend Johnny Torrio to kill their boss, Big Jim. Torrio is at first angered by the idea.
Get rid of Big Jim and you become Mr. Big.
He's my uncle. He's like a father to me.
Yeah, Johnny, I know that. I understand.
Capone uses reason, charm, and ultimately plays upon Torrio's one weakness, ambition.
He's blowing smoke, but he's got your ego involved. And so ego also gets involved because you may have daydreamed of being powerful. You may have daydreamed of being the head of the company. And here's a guy saying, hey, you should be. You should be. Pretty soon you say, yeah, I should be, right?
Jimmy, listen to me. Johnny Papa, please listen to me now. Do you want to go for the rest of your life taking dimes from a guy who makes dollars? Do you want to go for the rest of your life minding push cars, or do you want to be Mr. Big? You hear me, Johnny? Mr. Big, that's the man in charge.
Torrio did have Big Jim killed, and for a while became Mr. Big. But not for long. In 1924, Torrio fell victim to a drive-by shooting. Badly wounded and badly shaken, he quit the rackets. Capone now had a shot at the big time, control of Chicago. Like other gangsters, he had endured years of squalor, years of petty crime, years of mindless muscle. But unlike other gangsters, Capone had learned that honeyed words and greased palms could be just as effective as the blackjack and the gun. It's what made him special.
I like to think that Capone was different because he was a sort of a multidimensional gangster. He was not someone who simply understood profits and mayhem. He had some depth to him. He had a public relations ability. He was able to attract even editors and reporters to his cause, as he put it, delivering whiskey to a populace that desperately wanted whiskey and entertainment. So in many ways, he was a very astute business person.
His instinct for public relations was the key to Capone's success. Unlike the mafia, a Sicilian's only operation, Capone employed anyone with talent. In ethnically divided gangland, it was a smart move. He was a byproduct of immigration and the quest for the promised land. And as a true American, he was to get his biggest break, courtesy of the U.S. government. World War I had just ended. Americans were about to dance to a new tune, jazz. People were determined to live life to the full, but forces of reform were ranged against the partygoers, and the forces of reform won. In January 1920, the National Prohibition Act became law. Production, transportation, and sale of alcohol were suddenly illegal. But consumption was not. Al Capone spotted the loophole. And within hours of the Prohibition Act becoming law, he was stealing and supplying liquor to the thirsty citizens of Chicago. The bootlegging industry was born. How the mob moved from the barroom to the boardroom is the most amazing part of the American gangster story. It changed the way gangsters operate. It changed the way federal law responded to gangster crime. And it was to change the public image of the public enemies forever. As mob bosses grew more isolated, so Hollywood created a new gangster style. Movie gangsters had once been wisecracking underdogs, romantic outsiders taking a shot at the American dream. Now they became loners, haunted by doubt and personal demons. The new style was called film noir.
Nothing will stop me from wiping you all out.
It's got all the sinister characters. It certainly employs the gangster. But it robs him of his vitality. It robs him of being in the spotlight, of rising above the crowd, because there's a kind of general malaise that affects everybody in film noir. They're all haunted. They're all kind of affected by some nagging paranoia.
History calls the conflict the Castella-Marese Wars. This is the leading contender in the Castella-Marese conflict. Joe the Boss Masseria was a traditionalist. He believed that the families should stick to doing their own thing. An outfit runs on its own, he said, and knocks off anybody in its way. But this man disagreed. Salvatore Charlie Lucky Luciano saw the advantage of gangs working in combination. The mafia should do business outside the family, even with gangsters from other ethnic groups, like the Irish or the Jews. Luciano was not slow to practice what he preached. His lifelong consigliere, or advisor, was a Jewish childhood friend, Mayor Lansky. Even as a boy, Luciano cut a dapper figure in the New York underworld. By age 14, he was already a member of the notorious Five Point Street Gang and a natty dresser. 10 years later, and Luciano became a wealthy bootlegger. But the feud got out of hand. Within a year, over 100 would die. Luciano at first took the side of Joe, the boss, Masseria. But the bloodshed convinced him that the mob and the way it worked would have to change.
Charlie Lucky Luciano decided it was time to bring some structure to organized crime. And the idea that bullets were bad for business and that it attracted attention and it made for trouble and it was not worth it. And that they could make more money by getting together and having, in some way, an organization.
Luciano was sickened by the piecemeal killing. He resolved to end it with one last death. That of his one-time ally, Joe the Boss Masseria. It was to a restaurant in Coney Island that Luciano personally lured Joe the Boss Masseria in April 1931. The pretext? To discuss, over lunch and a friendly game of cards, the killing of Masseria's last Castellamarese rival. But as it turned out, Masseria himself was the target. Filmmakers later loved such events for their almost biblical flavor. For here, Luciano played Judas. He was the finger man. Six bullets later, Masseria was dead, and Luciano was chief mafioso in New York. Tucked into Masseria's lifeless and bloody hand, the ace of spades. It was a gruesome joke, typical of the lead trigger man, Benjamin Bugsy Siegel. The hit guaranteed Siegel a place at the mob's top table and a reputation for a love of violence.
I mean, what do you think of a guy who tells you, you want to kill me? Come on, here. Spins the bows, click. Nobody can kill me. I can't even kill myself. Click. Man, this guy was a maniac.
Siegel was another boyhood friend of Luciano. Together with Mayor Lansky, these three men came to dominate gangland during the 1930s. As new boss of America's biggest crime organization, Luciano moved quickly, and what he achieved was nothing short of revolutionary.
He knew there would be disputes. There would be disputes over who controlled certain areas, certain industries, over money. So by having the five families establish something called a commission, that's the name they used, like a board of directors, they almost set policy on what would be allowed to be done, what was prohibited, and at the same time, they were there to resolve disputes among the families.
Yeah, not bad. It was incredible. For the first time in one room, listening respectfully to a youthful Luciano, sat the heads of no less than five mafia gang families. Later named after their original bosses, Gambino, Genovese, Colombo, Lucchese, Bonanno. All were based in one city, New York, a combination so powerful that the five families rapidly became ganglords of the nation. The average American gangster now belonged to a syndicate, whether he liked it or not. But not everyone was ready to join up. In 1931, there was still one mob boss strong enough to stand out against the syndicate. In Chicago, Al Capone held absolute sway, and Capone wanted to keep it that way. Indeed, the idea of running the mob as a business had originated with him and his mentor, Johnny the Fox Torrio. The point is made in the only Hollywood biopic of Capone. The lead is played by actor Rod Steiger.
Protection from us.
He said, we're going to put down the guns. It's very simple. If they need milk, we got the milk. If they need transportation, we got the transportation. If they need napkins, knives and forks, beef, pork, milk, anything, we got it.
They got to come to us.
That's $100 million. Now, when I first came to this town to work for Big Jim and Johnny Torrio, it was gambling and it was dames, all right? Then came Prohibition. That meant the big dope for us. That gave us the working capital. Now we organize. Now we go legit. And we move into every legitimate business there is. You follow me? Now, Lefty, what are you peddling?
You know, beer and the hard stuff.
All right, from now on, only give them beer and the hard stuff. You give them candy, chewing gum, pretzels, anything you can think of. Louis and the hotels and the restaurants, not only are they going to pay for the linen, but the silverware, sugar balls, anything. And then when the linen gets dirty, they send to our laundry and our trucks. Right? That's the way it's going to be now, and anything and everything, right down the line. Anybody gives you any trouble, you tell them they should come to Al, right? Comes to Al Capone, right?
Right.
Capone could have played a leading role in the new-look mob. Luciano was ready to cut a deal with the big fellow. But the deal never closed. Capone was facing trial, and his days as Chicago head honcho were numbered. He was flamboyant. He was outrageous. The front page was always held for him. He was the most reviled and celebrated gangster of his age, Al Capone. As the new-look mob moved from barroom to boardroom, this man came to symbolize everything the new-style gangsters under Lucky Luciano rejected: prominence in the public eye. By 1931, Capone was already a household name. And through the movies, he rapidly became the icon of the gangster era.
People wanted to go and peek at what everyone was whispering about, and that whisper was about Al Capone. So when these sort of movies started to just explode onto the scene in the early 1930s, oh, they all had a tinge of Capone. They were all colored with that unspoken pointing a finger at, you know who we're talking about.
Capone's fame made him a target. The feds were determined to bring him down. But how they did it still stirs controversy today.
I have no problems with getting rid of bad people. And Capone, as I say, he was a big, brutal, bad man, okay? But you do it within the law. And this is the concern that I have.
Capone was making $25 million a year. He had personally killed at least half a dozen men and ordered the deaths of dozens more. Yet he was tried not as a bootlegger, racketeer, or murderer, but for income tax evasion.
It was a joke at the time. Here you got a man killing, robbing, bribing, doing every filthy crime known to mankind in the state of Illinois and the city of Chicago. Now he's being put away for income tax.
The tax rap was a surprise move. Most Americans didn't earn enough to pay income tax, and few took it seriously, least of all gangsters.
The filing of income tax then was not as it is today. Less than 10% of the people in the United States in those years, the 20s, had to pay income tax. So paying income tax wasn't something that we all accepted and knew. And Capone, he was no rocket scientist, obviously. That Capone should know about income tax, I don't know if we can buy into that.
But lawmen had good reason to go for the income tax angle. No one could prove that Capone himself had committed any gangster crimes. Capone's bagmen had paid others to do the dirty work for him. This was criminal conspiracy, but in 1931, such conspiracy was not a felony. For a decade, top gangsters had literally gotten away with murder. Capone had been the greatest American gangster of his day. To an admiring public, he had been a lovable rogue, the self-made Mr. Big Shot who took on the world and nearly won. After Capone, gangsters were no longer glamorous. They were simply mean. Capone's exit from the scene gave New York crime boss Lucky Luciano a free hand at imposing a new look on the mob. The mob was to become a thing of shadows. But all across America, times were changing fast, and events were nearly to overtake even the coldly calculating Luciano. A new president, Franklin D. Roosevelt, led a new government into repeal. It was the first ray of sunshine to warm an America chilled by economic depression. Overnight, drinkers came out of the closet, and they partied till dawn. Gangsters didn't join the celebrations. Prohibition had given them their greatest source of income, bootlegging. After the squeeze put on their activities by the Depression, many gangsters saw repeal as the last straw. Some gave up the rackets and drifted into the gutter. But the smart ones began to think of other ways to make a dirty dollar. They turned to an old favorite, gambling.
We're a sports-loving people.
Gambling had long held appeal for the mob. It was a victimless crime. It involved collusion and corruption, and gangsters could pose as Robin Hoods, providing the public with a service they wanted.
Illegal gambling, at least in America, is not looked upon them as a crime where they're victims. And organized crime, the mafia, has perfected gambling to such a degree that it's always has been and will continue to be one of their most lucrative occupations.
The main enforcer of mob gambling interests was syndicate boss Lucky Luciano's trusted lieutenant, Ben Bugsy Siegel. He went where the gamblers had money, and that meant spending more and more time in L.A. and in Hollywood. Siegel's job? To tie the mob into existing gambling setups. With every bet, gangsters got a percentage. It's a system that still exists today. On the streets of New York, a turf war broke out that overshadowed Siegel's West Coast gambling success. The new style low-profile mob was drawn into a battle for control of a street lottery called the Numbers Racket. The staging area was Harlem. And the main combatant was one of the oddest characters in gangland, Arthur Fleggenheimer, a.k.a. Dutch Schultz. In the groomed and stylish world of the public enemies, Schultz cut a strange figure.
The man was a multi-millionaire, but he was a cheapskate. He really was very tight. You know, he never wore anything, any kind of suit that cost over $28 or $30.
Schultz had made a fortune out of bootlegging in the Bronx, but he was a loner, a maverick, a loose cannon. He kept his dealings with Luciano and the syndicate to a minimum. Now he wanted the numbers in Harlem. He wanted all of the action.
To most gangsters, it was a penny ante thing, but not when you add up all those nickels and dimes and quarters, turn it to the millions. So he decided to, the same way he took over the beer rack, strong arm, okay? With his 45 on it, he would negotiate, shall we say, with that big 45.
But negotiations in Harlem proved bloody and costly. Schultz was in breach of the new style mobster's code. He was drawing too much attention to himself. And sure enough, he became a target of the law. Led to a stormy meeting of the mob's board of directors. The always fragile relationship between the syndicate and Schultz finally broke down.
It got to a point where he came out at a syndicate sit-down that he wanted to kill Tom Dewey.
Okay. But Luciano and the other bosses didn't want to hit a man as prominent as Thomas Dewey.
They discussed it. Schultz went into a rage. What kind of, what do you call this? You know, look, you don't want to do it with me? Fine, I'll do it on my own. So when he stormed out of the room, we got to take steps to protect Tom Dewey, because this loose cannon, this maniac, is going to ruin it for everybody. He's got to be hit. No question about it, he has to be hit.
This was the man chosen for the job, Charlie Workman, known to associates as the Bug.
The guy was a psychopathic killer, stone cold. And he'd kill anybody, believe me.
The venue for the hit was once again to be that favorite spot for mob murder, a restaurant. Charlie the Bug had chosen well. It was almost too easy.
He wiped out the Dutch Shills mob, just walked, barged right in, went in the back and started blazing away.
When police arrived on the scene, this is how they found Schultz, barely alive. He hung on for 3 days before death claimed him. The incorrigible Dutchman was no more. The Schultz hit marked a new phase in gangster history. Charlie the Bug and his cronies were different from the usual trigger men used in gangland executions. They were part of the most feared and hated group ever to emerge from the back alleys of organized crime. They came to be known as Murder Incorporated. And national mob boss Lucky Luciano ruthlessly enforced it. For Luciano, omerta, the code of silence, was everything.
He'll warn you once. You don't heed the warning, you're dead. That's it. Wrong.
He's got fit. Luciano knew he would need a way of controlling the mopes, bagmen, and soldiers that peopled his empire. His friend and confidant, Mayor Lansky, had the perfect solution, a group of contract killers comprising hitmen from both Jewish and Italian backgrounds. Between them, these hitmen would cover the ethnic spectrum of the mob. They became a kind of syndicate secret police, and those who defied the rulings of the mobster's board of directors soon understood that by so doing, they courted death. The killer's overall boss was New York gangster Louis Lepke Buchalter. Lepke set about his new job with cheerful zeal.
So anybody overstepping their territory would be eliminated. Witnesses would be eliminated. Even people that were fooling around with some guy's wife or whatever, they were eliminated, okay?
As bodies began turning up, the press got interested. Here was something new, and even for gangland, something particularly vicious. Killers for hire. They became the most feared and hated group of gangsters ever to emerge from the back alleys of urban crime. And the press soon gave them a name, Murder Incorporated.
Coast to coast, I think this organization killed in the vicinity of, or close to it, 500 murders they committed. It lasted, just about a decade.
In 1920, Prohibition arrived.
At first, Hollywood failed to pick up on Murder, Inc.'s decade of death. The 1930s remained a time of romantic gangster pictures. Only in the late 40s did movies begin featuring killers so ruthless they were a little short of insane.
I'm going to split 50-50 with a cop.
This one was written with a machine gun.
The crazed hitman was perhaps best portrayed by actor Richard Widmark, who starred with Victor Mature in the 1949 movie Kiss of Death.
Kids like to hit.
Widmark is a contract killer on the trail of a squealer. The staring eyes, the black shirt and white tie. Widmark defined movie gangsters for a decade.
Touch my family and you'll hear singing like you never heard before.
Gangsters might have been going crazy in the movies, but the thinking behind Murder, Inc. made perfect sense. To underworld minds, it was a beautiful creation.
The beauty part of this was that the killer had no connection with the victim at all. He didn't even know the guy. He just knew he had to kill him.
Murder, Inc. would kill anyone without question so long as the price was right. Men like Happy Maione and Frank Abbandando were no mere gangsters. They had no interest in rackets, gambling, or bootlegging. They did one thing and one thing only. They murdered. And for that, they charged top dollar. By the late 1930s, many mobsters were in custody, including the boss of bosses himself, Lucky Luciano. In 1936, Luciano was found guilty of running prostitutes. He claimed it was a frame-up, and it was. Police had planted evidence, yet Luciano was given the astonishing sentence of 30 years. The Luciano bust was a major triumph for the ambitious young prosecutor. It made him a national figure. As this later movie from 1960 showed, Lepke's death squads embarked on a killing spree which all but destroyed the mob.
Accounted for the incredible total of approximately 1,000 killings, executed by Murder Incorporated.
Finally, one man dared to break the silence. Abe Kid Twist Reles had coordinated dozens of Murder, Inc. hits. In 1939, this canary began to sing.
He knew the minute details of at least 85 murders. On a Good Friday, when he started singing, he sang a grand opera.
The heat was on, and Murder, Inc. boss Lepke Buchalter was the prize. He suddenly found himself a national fugitive. He was branded public enemy number one. Tom Dewey pursued him relentlessly.
This fugitive must be found dead or alive.
Lepke eventually surrendered at a fun fair on Coney Island, not far from where Lucky Luciano had fingered Joe the boss Masseria just 8 murder-filled years previously. Lepke was tricked into giving up without a fight. In 1941, Lepke was found guilty of murder and was sentenced to die in the electric chair. Eventually, 4 other Murder, Inc. stalwarts were to follow him into the death chamber.
Happy Maione, whose favorite weapon was a meat cleaver. Pittsburgh Phil Strauss, probably the most blood-lusting killer out of all Murder Incorporated. Bugsy Goldstein, Frank the Dasher Abbandando. Those 4 got the chair.
To this day, Lepke and his Murder, Inc. confederates remain the only top gangsters to be executed for murder. But not everyone enjoyed the fruits of the Murder, Inc. bust. In a small hotel here in Coney Island, the man who had played such a vital part in breaking the chain of silence and murder was to pay a heavy price for his collaboration with the DA. And the classic gangster era was about to enter its final phase. His testimony had already led to indictments of 5 top Murder, Inc. hitmen. Indictments that would send the killers to the electric chair. And Reles had more to say. He knew a lot of things about a lot of powerful people.
He was mentioning politicians, police brass, top police brass politicians, as well as gangsters. This guy has to go.
No wonder that some mobsters decided to quit town. Among them was the mob's gambling chief, Benjamin Bugsy Siegel. To get away from the mounting hysteria in New York, Siegel headed west to his favorite stomping ground, Hollywood. Siegel had spent a lot of time in Los Angeles looking after the mob's West Coast gambling operation. He was increasingly out of step with the way the mob was going. Not for him, the back alleys of Murder Incorporated, or the dull boardroom sessions of the National Syndicate. Instead, Siegel played the role of the classic gangster, spending money, hogging the limelight, living the high life. And Tinseltown took him to its heart.
You're cute.
Hollywood had spent the 1930s obsessed with the romantic image of the lovable gangster. And Siegel seemed to fit that role. Siegel looked like a movie star. He lived like a movie star. It was rumored he wanted to be a movie star. He was the last of the maverick gangsters. His life and death would come to symbolize the end of the classic gangster era. At first, Siegel lived here in the luxury of the Argyle Hotel, North Hollywood. Among such high-class surroundings, he began hobnobbing with movie people, including an old friend, actor George Raft.
Bugsy Siegel came to Hollywood, and he was seen around actors and film producers in a nightclub, became very friendly with them, and also met George Raft.
Raft was well known for his connections with the New York mob. He and Siegel had been friends since the 1920s. Together, they hatched a daring business plan.
They decided to go to Las Vegas, which was actually nothing but desert land, and they decided to build a casino for gambling purposes. And the name of the casino was called the Flamingo.
The Flamingo was ambitious, even for Siegel. It was so called after the nickname for Siegel's red-headed girlfriend, a singer named Virginia Hill. Siegel's dream was to build a gambling paradise within driving distance of L.A., but free of California's strict gambling laws. He had sold the idea to the National Syndicate, and the mob had bankrolled the project heavily. Siegel entertained lavishly to attract prospective patrons and secure favorable publicity. He became the darling of the Beverly Hills party circuit. Siegel's partner, actor George Raft, also did his bit to drum up support for the new club. But then things began to go wrong.
George Raft was to bring in people from Hollywood to keep the business going. And as we know today, Bugsy Siegel had borrowed some money from the underground world, and Bugsy Siegel's girlfriend somehow was able to manage to get her hands on $2.5 million and disappeared, went to Switzerland.
Virginia Hill had taken the mob's money on the lam. It was to be her boyfriend's downfall. In June 1947, the National Syndicate voted on the fate of Bugsy Siegel. For years, Siegel had defied their rulings. He had thumbed his nose at their edicts. He had become dangerously visible. Now he had ripped them off. Benny Siegel was the last of his kind. The other greats of the classic gangster era were already either dead, dying, or on ice. Dutch Schultz murdered, Lepke Buchalter executed, Al Capone desperately ill. In a world where gangsters had become businessmen, Siegel just didn't fit in. He was out of step with the way the mob was heading. He would have to go.
I'm telling you straight. Forget that you ever seen him.
What happened next made a memorable climax to the 1991 Oscar-winning movie Bugsy. Alone at home, the doomed mobster entertains himself by running his own movie screen test. Outside, an assassin lurks.
I was worrying about Henry. I figured I wouldn't marry him because he is a regular guy, and he's been swelled, but now I must marry him. I'm so sorry.
The murder said it all. A gangster obsessed with his own self-image sees his life shatter around him. The fancy decor, the stylish suit, the sexy mall, the movie glamour. All of it smashed by bullets from a paid killer. Siegel was the last of the flamboyant gangsters. Gangsters became corporation men. But in the public's imagination, they still retained that Hollywood style. Their exploits lived on, forever symbolized by some of the biggest stars in motion picture history. As gangsters retreated from the streets into the boardroom, they also retreated into legend.